welcome you here at worship at Christ Church United Methodist here in Charleston, West Virginia. I'm Jay Parkins. I'm the lead pastor here at Christ Church, and we're so glad that you've chosen to join us for worship today. We gather together on this special day, a special weekend in our life. It's the fifth Sunday after Pentecost, and it's also, again, the 4th of July weekend, a time when we celebrate freedom and the things that make us who we are. In these trying times, we pray that this time of worship will be helpful to you, for we know the disease continues to run rampant throughout our nation, and we pray for healing and grace for you and for all people. If you've not been able to download a copy of our bulletin or have not received one via email, we invite you to go to our website at ccumwv.org, where you can receive a copy of our bulletin and follow all of the prayers in our liturgies and our worship today. But my sisters and brothers, wherever you are, we invite you to center yourselves in the space in which you find yourself, to allow God's grace to fill you as we worship God together.
Good morning. I'm Pastor Jonathan Moon. I'm the associate pastor here, and it is my joy to be the liturgist for us this morning. So I would invite everyone, wherever they are, in body or spirit, as you are able, please rise and join us in our call to worship this morning. You break in, O God, on the road. You break in, O God, exactly the way we don't believe. You break in, O God, and change everything. You break in, O God, with a call. You break in, O God, with an invitation. You break in, O God, with the truth. You break in, O God, with a new realm. You break in, O God, with a new world. You break in, O God, with your intent for the future. God, break in again and call us to be your workers. God, break in again and use the gifts that we are to build your realm. God, break in again and change our world once more. Break into our presence, O God, as we worship you this day. Let us join together and sing, Love Lifted Me.
Completely saves. He will lift you. master of the sea, billows his will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me.
Let us come now and join together in our opening prayer. Please join with me. Just as Saul becomes Paul after his experience with the risen Christ on that road to Damascus, so too we pray that the risen Christ will meet us here in our time of worship and change us. We pray that the same power, grace, and love can humble us when we, like Saul, are doing wrong, even if it is in your name. Lord Jesus, we open ourselves to you and to your calling on our lives. Amen. And so as we enter into this time of sharing the peace of Christ, let us share the peace of Christ with each other. You can share it in your homes. You can share it on the phone. Please share it in our news feed, but receive it now from me. The peace of Christ be with you, as Christ's peace is with all of us. It is time for our moments with children. And so if you are a child or you have a child in your home, I would invite you to come on in close so we can gather together and start off with a big good morning. Okay, so I need you to be really loud, okay? Let's try it on the count of three. One, two, three. Good morning! Oh, I feel so much better already, because I know you all said it with me. And we are together. And the goodness of this morning is because God is with us. And we are with each other. So thank you for joining me. I wanted to talk to you a little bit more about what we spoke on last week. About change. There's a story in the Bible. And it's a long story. And we're going to hear different pieces of it in the next couple of weeks. It's a story of a man named Saul, who also gets a name changed to Paul. But last week we saw that Saul was a bit of a bully. And I promised you that with God's love, real change can happen. And I wanted you to know that the story today, God's love breaks in again. And Saul feels a change come over him in an awesome way. But I know change is real because I too have felt it. So I wanted to share with you just a little bit. When I was in second grade, are you all in second grade? If you're in second grade, raise your hand in your home. Maybe, yeah. Well, when I was in second grade, I used to get angry a lot. You see, I was little. And so I would get angry that I was smaller than my brother. I would get angry that my teacher didn't give me better grades. I would get angry that I wasn't as fast as my friend. I would get angry that I couldn't reach the cookie jar on the top of the fridge, or that I couldn't lift my dad's suitcase when he asked for help. I would just get angry all the time. And it seemed like everything would trigger a blinding rage. When I say blinding, it means I couldn't think or I couldn't see. I would literally get all red and all my veins would pop out, and I would not really remember that I could have fun or that I could share or that I could love. And instead, I would get into fights. I only got in like one fight with one other little boy. Most of the time, I got in fights with trees and rocks, and they won every time. But I remember one day coming home and my mom telling me something very simple, because she knew I didn't want to be angry anymore. She said, "John, have you asked Jesus to help?" And I thought about it, and I hadn't. So I began to do something really powerful that day. I began to ask Jesus in prayer, "Jesus, can you help me with my anger?" Specifically, I said, "Jesus, I don't want to be angry anymore." But instead of taking away my anger, God helped open up my eyes so that I could still be angry, because there are some things worth being angry over. But I could also remember that anger doesn't win. Love does. And so, just as I was angry that I would have to move so many times, I had my eyes open. I could see all the incredible adventures and new friends I could make. Just as I was angry that I couldn't help carry the big heavy things, I began to understand that I was small enough that I could reach places and get things that my dad could never get to. There was a lot of goodness when I realized I didn't have to be angry all the time, and it's because Jesus helped me. And so I want to ask you, if there's anything you want help with this morning, anything you might want to change about yourself, feel free to pray. Jesus wants to help. It may not come like you want, because I still get angry, but you know, I'm glad I do, because Jesus taught me that sometimes, all the time, love wins. So let us just come now to a time of prayer and a big amen. Please join me. Dear God, thank you for changing my heart, for leading me forward to love you always. Let's do a big amen. Amen. Thank you all so very much. So let's go back and hear the rest of that story of Paul today as he continues his journey. The story continues in the book of Acts, and it's chapter 9, verses 1 through 22. Meanwhile, Saul was still spewing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest seeking letters to the synagogues in Damascus. If he found persons who belonged to the way, what we call Christianity now, whether men or women, these letters would authorize him to take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. During the journey, as he approached Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven encircled him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice asking him, "Saul, Saul, why are you harassing me?" And Saul asked, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus, whom you are harassing," came the reply. "Now get up and enter the city. You will be told what you must do." And those traveling with him stood there speechless. They had heard the voice but saw no one. And after they picked Saul up from the ground, he opened his eyes, but he couldn't see. And so they led him by the hand into Damascus. And for 3 days he was blind and neither ate nor drank anything. Now in Damascus there was a certain disciple named Ananias. And the Lord spoke to him in a vision. Ananias! He answered, "Yes, Lord." The Lord instructed him, "Go to Judas's house on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias enter and put his hands on him to restore his sight." And Ananias countered, "Lord, I have heard many reports about this man. People say he has done horrible things to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he's here with the authority from the chief priest to arrest everyone who calls on your name." The Lord replied, "Go. This man is the agent I have chosen to carry my name before Gentiles, kings, and Israelites. I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." And Ananias went to the house. He placed his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord sent me, Jesus, who appeared to you on the way as you were coming here. He sent me so that you could see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Instantly, flakes fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after eating, he regained his strength. And he stayed with the disciples in Damascus for several days. And right away, he began to preach about Jesus in the synagogues. "He is God's son," he declared. And everyone who heard him was baffled. They questioned each other, "Isn't he the one who is wreaking havoc among those in Jerusalem who called on his name, or on this name? Hadn't he come here to take those same people as prisoners for the chief priests?" But Saul grew stronger and stronger. He confused the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Christ. And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Oh, hi. That was the day that changed my life. I've never been the same ever since that moment. You see, after Stephen's murder, I now realize that's what it was. Then I thought it was an execution. But after Stephen's death, I had gone throughout Jerusalem trying to round up those Jesus followers. I threw many of them in prison. And leaders had scattered. They'd left the city. And I'd heard that there was a group in Damascus. And so I went to the leaders of the Sanhedrin. And I received letters so I could go arrest them. They even said I could take some of their temple guard with me. And so we set out on that road to go to Damascus and round them up. I was feeling pretty good about myself. It was a long, hot, dusty road, but it seemed like I had everything I needed to finally eradicate this sect of heretics. And as we were going along the road that day, suddenly there was a bright light. It was so bright, it was like nothing I had ever seen before. It enveloped me, and it brought me down to my knees. And then in the midst of that voice, midst of that light, there was a voice. And the voice said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" I didn't know what was going on. I knew it couldn't be lightning or some natural phenomena. It was brighter than that, and there was a voice. And so I asked, I said, "Who are you?" And he said, "I'm Jesus, the one you've been persecuting." I couldn't believe it. Jesus, really? And then he said, "Go on into the city. And then you will know what you are to do." And then just as suddenly, the light vanished and the voice was gone, but I couldn't see. I was blind. I tried to get up and I reached out and I cried out to my companions, "Did you hear it? Did you see it?" And they said they'd heard something, but they didn't know what it was. But they knew that it must be something holy. And then they helped me get to my feet, and I was so blind I couldn't see. There were tears coming down my eyes. They burned. And then they led me down the road, and we walked those many more miles into the city. My mind was confused. I couldn't see. I was blind. And that voice, the voice, I couldn't understand it. When we got to the city, my companions found me a place to stay. And I went into the room and fell down on the floor. I prayed and cried out to God, just like the psalmist, why had God done this to me? I cried and cried. They brought me food, but I couldn't eat. This went on for several days. I was wondering what was happening to me. Why had God done this to me? What was this about? I could not understand. And I prayed for someone to come and explain it all to me. And then one day I heard a knock on the door. I couldn't see, of course, so I couldn't get up. And I just said, come on in. And I heard the door open, and the person come slowly across the room. They were very tentative. I couldn't understand why. I was blind. I couldn't do anything. I was helpless. Still, they were tentative. And then he spoke out and said, I'm Ananias. I'm a follower of this Jesus. I couldn't believe a follower of Jesus would come to me. Didn't he know I'd been out to arrest them? Didn't he know I was the one who had stood there while they killed Stephen? Yet still, he came to me. He said, this Jesus that appeared to you on the road has come to me. And he's told me to come and to minister to you. May I? I didn't know what to think, so I said, yeah, sure. And then he reached out and he touched me right on my eyes with his hand. And when he did, it was like scales fell from my eyes and I could see again. I couldn't believe it. I could see. And then this Ananias, he continued to talk to me. And he told me that this Jesus that had come had told him that I was the one who would continue to spread the word. That I was the one who would take the good news to the Gentiles. I was the one that would proclaim this Jesus as the Messiah. I was confused by what he was saying, but from his voice and my experience on the road, I felt that maybe it was true. That maybe what he was saying was true, and I began to know it and to feel it. And then he went on and he said, Jesus had called all of his followers to be baptized. And I began to think, well, why shouldn't I? And so he got up and he went over to another part of the room and he got a bowl of water. And he brought that water back over to where I was sitting and he poured it over my head in the name of God the Father and this Jesus. And the Holy Spirit. And as the water ran down my head and my face and onto my clothes, I felt a power in me. It wasn't the violent or self-righteous power I had felt when they killed Stephen and when we were coming down the road. It was something different. But it was a power. A power that touched me to the very core of my being. It was a power that touched my heart. It was like I was embraced in this loving presence. And I realized that this presence was that voice, this Jesus. And I couldn't believe it. And then Ananias brought me some food, and I ate some, and as my strength got back and I grew stronger, we went to his house. And while we were there, he introduced me to the other believers in his house. And of course, they were very tentative at first. They said, what are you doing bringing this guy here? And then he told them my story of how I had encountered this Jesus on the road. And then he told them of his story, how Jesus had told him to come and to heal me. And how I was blind, but now I could see. And that Jesus said, I was now one of them, one to lead in sharing the good news. And we spent several days there at the house, and they began to tell me more about Jesus, about how he healed people and how he had forgiven sin and how he had gone about doing all of these things across the countryside. And then they told me about how he had died. I knew that. I'd seen it. And how he'd been crucified, but that he had risen from the dead and that he'd appeared to them. And that then they had watched as he had been risen up into the heavens to glory. I'd heard all of those stories before. But this time I was able to hear. This time I was able to listen. And as they talked, I began to recognize how all of my studies of the prophets and the writings and all of that, that they all began to make sense relative to this Jesus. And that maybe he was the suffering servant from Isaiah. And that how he was the fulfillment of all the promises. And I began to recognize that this Jesus was who he said he was. He was the Messiah. It changed my world. Totally. And then I went with those followers then to the synagogue, and I began to stand up and talk about what I'd experienced and what I'd found, and the people couldn't believe it. I could hear them talking in the background. Could this be Saul? Wasn't he an opponent to this sect? Didn't he come to arrest them? What is this? It must be some kind of a trick. He must be trying to deceive us. But I wasn't. I was different. I had changed. I realized that they were children of God and that we all were children of God, no matter who we were, and that this Jesus had come to show us that. And so I began to teach that and go to the scriptures and explain how he had come and how he was Lord of all and how all of this now made sense, even for the Gentiles. The Gentile. Well, the religious leaders of that synagogue didn't like it then. And they began harassing me. Word came that they were even seeking to kill me. And so Ananias and those other followers of Jesus, late one night, they took me to the edge of the town, and I got in a basket, and they lowered me down the wall, and I left. I knew I couldn't go back to Jerusalem. So I went out into the desert. I went out and prayed and fasted for weeks, trying to understand what had happened to me. And then I eventually made my way back to Tarsus, my hometown. And I began to study there and pore over the scriptures. And it seemed that more and more this God showed me that this Jesus was the one. And it began to make more and more sense. And I began to teach and tell everyone I met about this Jesus and how he was Lord of all, not just for the Jews, but for all the world, the Gentiles and everyone, no matter who they were. We were all his children. And I guess word got back to the leaders in Jerusalem, because one day Barnabas came to me there in Tarsus. And then we went back to Jerusalem together. And I told them my story. And he explained what he had witnessed with me in Tarsus. And then began my great adventure. An adventure that's been so wonderful, yet also so hard. This adventure of going out and sharing the good news of Jesus to everyone. To try to form churches where everyone could be together, no matter who they were, no matter what they looked like, no matter what color, no matter what country they were from, whether they were Jews or slaves, it didn't matter. Because Jesus made us one. It's been hard. But it all started with that moment on the road. That moment when this Jesus came to me. Appearing in a way that I could never have imagined, but coming and calling me Saul, to be his disciple. And then sending this Ananias, someone I'd never met, who showed me should have just not cared about me at all, to come and heal me and share what Jesus had told them. It all started there. And I know that no matter where I go, no matter what I do, all I can do is seek to live into that call to be His disciple, surrendering it all to Him. I'd like to tell you more about my experiences, but I hear the guards out there, and they're coming, and I got to finish this letter to the church in Corinth. Those guys always seem to be in conflict. I don't know what's going on there. I have to write them constantly and remind them, always reminding them, that our Jesus came to bring reconciliation for us and for everyone. And if I have to keep writing them letters from now on, I will, because it's that important. Shalom, my friends.
This is I desperate for you.
Lost without him. Saul was lost. He just didn't realize it at the time. But that moment on the road to Damascus changed his life forever. It's probably one of the most loved and famous stories in Scripture. We get it three times in the book of Acts, I think, and Paul reiterates it later in his letters. Because his encounter with Jesus was that profound. I realize that for many people, reading such profound experiences in Scripture and then maybe encountering someone who had a majestic experience of an encounter with Jesus sometimes leaves us feeling like we're less than. But that's not true. Because Jesus comes to each of us in the way that we need to hear. Maybe it's in a quiet voice rather than a flash of light and great sound. Maybe it's simply sitting and looking at the Word and reading Scripture and suddenly it all makes sense. But the thing is, Jesus comes. And Jesus comes to each of us calling to us and wanting to change our hearts, just as he changed Saul. He wants us to recognize and to let go of things that divide. He wants us to put our full trust in him, even when doing so seems totally different than anything that we had encountered before. But the thing that Saul's story also reminds me is that sometimes as Jesus comes to us, our understanding of what it all means comes from someone else coming to us. Someone who perhaps was our enemy. Someone who perhaps we never really understood before. Perhaps someone who is doing things I can't understand. But then in that interaction in Christ's love, our eyes are opened. And we begin to see what the kingdom of God is supposed to be. What God's true intentions are for this world, even if what we had been taught was different. That was Saul's experience. And Saul then went and shared that. Shared it with everyone he could meet and began to form this thing that we call the church. My prayer, sisters and brothers, is that each of us today will open up our hearts to that light of grace, which is Jesus, that we will allow him to heal our blindness, whatever that blindness might be, and that he would open our eyes so that we can live as his people, and then join with Saul and that long litany of folks who have gone forth to proclaim that good news to everyone they meet. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now as we move to the time for our time of prayer, We invite you, as always, to share your prayer requests through the comment section on the Facebook feed, or you can send them into the office by email. We want to be able to pull those prayer concerns together so that we can all be in prayer together, even though we may not be here today together. So please do so. And now, as we center ourselves and prepare ourselves for prayer, I also invite you to use this prayer time to open yourself to the power and grace of this God who comes unexpectedly but can change us if we will but allow it. Let us sing together. Encountered Saul on the road and opened his eyes. It was you who changed his heart. It was you who empowered him to proclaim the good news throughout the world. Oh God, in this day in which we live, there is much to fear. We hear daily of how the virus is increasing. We know there are hot spots where many have fallen ill. As we gather for our summer holiday celebrations of the birth of our nation, we see great tensions throughout our country. We see many who seek to divide rather than unite. We seek to revisit our history and come to understand things better. These are difficult things, Lord. But just as your light brought healing and strength to Saul, we know that your light and your grace can bring healing and strength to us, bringing healing where there is a need for it, where there is illness, bringing healing where there's a need for it of broken hearts over lost loved ones, bringing healing where there's a need for it among peoples, bringing healing when there's a need for it to reconcile ourselves with our past, bringing healing that can literally change us. And we give you thanks, praying for that healing to be among us, to touch us, to the core of our being, just as you touch Saul, and helping us to live in that light of love. For Lord, this world needs that love today. Please pour it out among all people. those here around us in Charleston, those throughout our nation, and those throughout the world. May we see the light of grace. May we see the light of truth, which unites us as sisters and brothers, united in your love and power. May it be so, O God. May it be so. In the name of that one who came to Saul on the road, this Jesus the Christ, who invites us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, as we prepare for our time of offering, I know you can see on the screen the ways in which to give. I was asked to share with you today, though, it is the first Sunday of the month, and is our custom in Christ Church. This is the Sunday when we collect a special offering, an extra offering, for our assistance ministry. The assistance ministry has been ongoing during these times when we have not been gathering. We've been meeting needs of folks. Now, to be honest, the need was not as great there for a number of weeks. But when I spoke to our volunteers who assist with that program, they told me this week we received 9 calls instead of the average of 2. And as you've probably noticed in reading the paper, that now landlords can evict folks who have not been paying their rent. Now is a time when utilities can go and shut off utilities. And so we realize that the need will be great in the weeks ahead. So we pray that as you give your regular offering, you might also take a moment to send a special offering for the assistance ministry. You can do so by text. You can do so by mailing in a check through the same methodologies. Just mark it for the assistance ministry. But most especially today, let us all offer not just our monetary gifts. Let us offer our hearts and our souls to this Jesus, who is the light of the world.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below.
Our hymn of response is one of my favorites, and it's one of my favorites because it combines one of those old hymns of faith, Amazing Grace, a hymn that's so well known and beloved, that has touched so many hearts for so many years, and joins it with that chorus that our chains are gone and we're set free. Wherever you are, I invite you to stand and I invite you to sing this hymn with gusto, trusting in the grace of that love to be yours.
That's right.